happy to be with you today. We are a husband and wife duo, and we love to play all different kinds of music, bluegrass, Americana, klezmer, old time. We love to write our own songs and play traditional music as well. And we're going to tell you a little bit about our musical traditions today, our music heritage, and we're going to do a couple songs for you as well.
I'm John Cloyd Miller. I'm originally from Hickory, North Carolina. I'm a 12th generation North Carolinian, if you can believe that. My musical lineage comes mostly from my mom's side of the family. My grandfather, Jim Shoemate, was a pioneering bluegrass fiddle player. He was sort of there at the genesis of bluegrass. He was originally from Wilkes County, and he came from a family of musicians himself. His sister played klezmer banjo, his older brother played fiddle, his uncle played fiddle. And he was playing on the radio in the mid-1940s, and Bill Monroe heard him and called him up for a job. So he was in the Bluegrass Boys with Bill Monroe in the mid-40s, and 45 particularly, and later introduced Earl Scruggs to Bill Monroe. That was one of his big claims to fame, as he sort of brought those guys together and helped bluegrass sort of synthesize into this sound. Later he was Flatt & Scruggs' first fiddler when they broke off and started their own act in 1948. And he was a real big influence on me, of course. I learned pretty much everything I know about playing bluegrass music from him and Clarence Green, that he used to play with. And Jim was also a songwriter, and I don't think I would be a songwriter today, really, if it hadn't been for his influence. That's the tradition that I like to carry on. There's not too many people in my family actively playing music anymore. Some people have passed on, and there's just not a lot of it. They're all music fans and love it, but I feel lucky that I'm able to carry that on with my own music, and certainly playing some of Jim's as well. We actually have his fiddle here today. We were going to play a song that he wrote. I was going to show you a picture real quick. This is Jim right here. This is a collection of home recordings that Wayne Erbsen did in the 70s. It just came out on the Field Recorders Collective. So, Jim made a lot of records, mostly in the 90s, but this was a bunch of stuff that wasn't recorded. So we're happy to have that, and we thought we'd play one of his most popular compositions today. This is one, a gospel number. He was a very devout Baptist, and this is a tune he wrote that Bill Monroe later recorded. Graham Parsons and Emmylou Harris played this song as well. It's called The Old Country Baptism.
1, 2, 3. Traveling down the country road on one Sunday morning, I saw a crowd down at the creek on a little country farm. I thought I would move closer and that I might see them. Why they look so happy there, it's not a thing. Have you here? Welcome now, my friends. We've held a great revival circuit up at the church all week, and now we're having our baptizing here in the creek. Was a good old country baptizing, and I was at that day. We'll preach a while and sing a while, and all kneel down and pray. God's spirit. The good old country preacher. gospel to the crowd, holding a sinner's arms. Said you'll be happy, praise the Lord, I feel it in my soul. And someday we'll fly to heaven on your wings of gold. Now I'm glad that I can be among the happy throng and see them wash their sins away while they're at their homes. You can almost hear them say a smile upon their face. I'm ready now to move along on to my resting place. Was a good old country baptizing, and I was at that thing. We'll preach a while and sing a while and all kneel down and pray. God's bed seemed to fill the air and every soul was weak. At the good old country baptizing here in the creek.
Yeah, it's a great song, and Jim was an amazing musician, and he was a huge influence, obviously, on John and on me as well. I got to play with him for about 8 years before he passed away, and he taught me a lot about how to loosen up and play with groove. And yeah, for me, coming from a classical music background, it was really a different style of playing. So it was a lot of fun to play with him.
Yeah, Jim didn't really have a whole lot of students, and his recordings haven't really been out there all that much. And Natalya really studied with him quite a bit. Another friend of mine, Ben Wartina, studied with Grandpa quite a bit, and he had a couple other students over the years, but she's really learned a lot of his tunes. And recently Michael Cleveland recorded one of his tunes on his Grammy award-winning album this last year, and so it's great to see his music getting out there a little bit more. And we're sure proud of Grandpa. His brother, incidentally, bought this fiddle for him back in, I guess, the 30s. Grandpa said that his brother Mac gave $17.50 for this fiddle, and it's been all over the place on the Grand Ole Opry, on the Mercury recordings with Flat and Scruggs. There's a lot of music that's come out of that fiddle. Well, Natalya comes from a wonderful musical background as well, something that's really was, I have to say, kind of foreign to me before I met her. I didn't really know a lot about this music tradition, and it's been so enlightening and wonderful for me to learn more about it, and I'll let her tell you a little more about that.
So I also come from a musical family, my grandfather was a professional klezmer musician, which is, for those of you that may not be familiar with klezmer music, it's like Jewish folk music that originated in Eastern Europe and then came over with immigrants, you know, to here to America, and sort of became an American music form as well. And it's, you know, usually we don't think of Jewish music as being part of the Appalachian music experience or even the Southern music experience. But, you know, there's been a lot of Jewish people here, especially like in Asheville for over 100 years. There was a significant Jewish population here. And so it's been kind of fun to think about adding klezmer to the canon of traditional music, I guess, in the state of North Carolina, particularly. But my grandfather has a really interesting story. Music kind of saved his life, is sort of the story that has been passed down in my family. He grew up in what's now Ukraine, in Russia. And he was drafted into the Red Army, but somebody heard that he was a musician, and so he ended up being able to play in the band and not have to fight on the front lines. So he always said that music saved his life in that way. And then he eventually escaped out of Russia on a hay wagon with his brother and immigrated to the United States in 1923. He arrived, and my father was born here, and my dad's a great jazz piano player, so we've got that in the family as well. But yeah, my grandfather always used to tell my dad, don't ever try to make a living as a professional musician. And my dad got that memo. I missed it until it's too late, but yeah. That's okay. So anyways, it's been really fun. You know, I kind of came to klezmer through the, very circuitous route of, studying classical violin and then getting into bluegrass and old time and moving to Asheville in 2004 is, when we started playing together. And then kind of actually through an Appalachian Studies program, in researching my own family history is sort of how I got more interested in the klezmer background. So we've been enjoying learning and playing more klezmer music, and we're going to try a couple of songs that were in my grandpa's repertoire for you today.
Yeah, you have the sheet music to one of these. And
yeah, this is my grandfather's handwritten sheet music, so we tried to decipher it and work it up. It just says Freilach at the top there. We're going to play a hora and a Freilach, which are two types of Jewish dances. We also have a photo of my grandfather, David Weinstein. He was a wind player, so he played saxophone and flute.
It's been really fun learning about this, at least for myself. Wherever we go and play, klezmer music, you don't hear a whole lot of it in the South that much anyway, really. And it's really not out there too much, and maybe in Philadelphia and New York and some big cities and places like that. But wherever we go and we play these, sort of Appalachian klezmer fusion songs, people really have been enjoying it. I don't know if it's just something different that they really like. What really strikes me about klezmer music is the emotiveness of it. That's something that I always look for in music anyway. And I love the bends and the ornamentation of the music really sort of mimics the human emotive thing. Violins and clarinets, I think, traditionally were lead instruments in klezmer music, and they're sort of registered with the human voice. So it's where they're pitched is.
Yeah, they can really mimic the sounds of bends and the kind of crying sounds. And I think, the joke with Jewish music is like, it's crying 1 minute and then laughing the next. sort of have, these minor kind of sounding chords and this kind of dancing, happy feel. And it's sort of, it's these, the human experience is a wide range of emotions, right? And you can kind of hear that in these two dance tunes. So we're going to try Hoffman's Hora and David's Freilach for you, which is actually our most recent single with Zoe and Cloyd. You can find it on Apple Music and, all the streaming platforms. But it was a lot of fun to record. There's bluegrass banjo on the recording as well. So we'll try it for you today with just fiddle and guitar.
Yeah. Thank you. That's fun.
Thanks so much for tuning in and listening to us today. Again, we're Zoe and Cloyd, Natalya Zoe Weinstein, and John Cloyd Miller from Asheville, North Carolina. And we really appreciate your support of the arts during these times.
Yeah, you can look us up online, zoeandcloyd.com, and we're on all the social media platforms. So find us and follow us. We'd love to see you.
Yeah, keep in touch. Take care.